First, it was a smart city challenge. Then a Swachh Bharat challenge. Then came a new livability index to make cities fight to rank themselves high. And now you have a housing challenge to select the most cost-effective technology for affordable housing. Well, seems the Housing and Urban Development Ministry is definitely in a very competitive mood. So today on Urban Reality, let's get to the bottom of the latest tech challenge for affordable housing. And these are the three big questions we'll get answers for. Our first question, what does a technology challenge for affordable housing really mean or entail? Our second question, can construction technology really speed bridge the affordable housing gap? Because if you look at the numbers so far, of that target of 2 crore homes, only 25 lakhs have been sanctioned and only 1.25 lakh homes have actually been made. Our final question for Urban Reality today, are state agencies enabled to take on this technology housing challenge? After all, housing is a state subject. Joining me to discuss all of this is Mr. Anoop Kumar Mittal. He's the man in charge of the construction company chosen by the ministry to lead this initiative. So, Mr. Mittal, my first question to you is, what is really this low-cost technology challenge? What does the ministry have in mind while announcing this? It's very sketchy, the information available so far.
You see, when we talk about affordable housing, there are, of course, two components in that. One is land cost and another is the construction cost. And land cost, mm-hmm. we all know that it all depends on the location, the place where this land is. Let us not talk about that. The main challenge is the construction cost and the speed of the construction. So our ministry and NBCC are working on this, and we are exploring the possibility how we can bring and import new technologies in construction. And recently in one of the messages, Honorable Prime Minister has also said that India need latest technology in construction for next 10 years, 15 years. And if you see the past, okay. Still we are in the era of brick and mortar construction everywhere. So now mm-hmm. we are working on that, and we have our R&D center. We are working on that, and latest few technologies we have identified. And one of the technology on which we are working very aggressively is 3D printing technology in construction, which is, companies are working in Russia, China, and Dubai. And we are also importing that technology, and that technology can give you houses in 7 to 10 days time, even single story houses.
Wow.
So we are working on that, and hopefully in next couple of quarters you will see at least one project we will start on this technology. This is the latest thing which we are doing. Other than this normal construction technologies, I don't know whether you know it or not, the Maiwan shuttering, slip form shuttering, tunnel okay. form shuttering, where less labor components are there. So what pledge we have taken as company and the Ministry of Urban Development, that all our new projects will be on new technology. That is guidelines issued by Ministry of Urban Development. And they have also revised their schedule of rates for this kind of technology.
So are these, the press note said that 16 technologies have already been approved, have been probably tested and tried out by NBCC. Do you also have cost savings in these technologies, using these technologies, or is it really just crunching the timelines of delivering these houses or constructing these houses?
No, both way. This is there is cost cutting also. I can say by adopting these technologies, cost is almost 22 to 25% less than the what conventional construction we do. Because all these technology-based construction is less labor, less defects, so almost 20 to 25% less cost.
Okay.
And of course, time is the main thing. Yeah.
Time is the main thing. Okay. Mr. Mittal, most of these technologies, whether it's 3D printing technologies or the other ones that you've just outlined, have been available in the public domain for the longest time. What has prevented both, let's say, government bodies who are doing this work at state level or states to actually adopt them. What has been the missing link and why are we still at brick and mortar stage?
You see, the main thing is our psychological feeling that still we Indian believe that until unless the house which we are making is based on concrete or reinforcement and brick and heavy plaster thickness, other than this we don't feel that house is safe, strong. And when we go for these kind of technologies, we don't believe that still people are making their houses, they go for curing the house themselves, whether he's secretary or lowest person of level. So psychologically, we still feel that until unless reinforcement bahut pada hai, cement bahut dal gaya hai, tab makan pakka hai. Whether that is, workmanship is
right.
Poor
okay,
or good
I,
or
I,
not.
I,
but
I think you've really brought the real psychology behind us still wanting a brick in a cement house. So out of the technologies which have been identified, how many has NBCC really used when you've been also building the houses, sir?
You see, now, at least the last 6 months, except 3D printing technology, we are using all technologies in our all projects,
wow.
Whether
okay.
That is housing, okay. Residential or non-residential.
Okay, fantastic. Now let me come to then the question of what challenges do you foresee in actually getting states on board, sir? And what would your biggest challenge be, NBCC's biggest challenge? Because I hear that the ministry is actually convening a state meeting next week to introduce the states to these 16 technologies. Am I right?
Right, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. So what are the challenges? What are you going to be talking to states about? What are the roadblocks which have to be removed?
You see, the fact is that state government officials and the machinery is not equipped to accept these technologies. So we have to tell them, and I don't think they will oppose this. The only thing which we have to do, we have to showcase some of the pilot projects on these technologies. Then only people will believe. Mm-hmm. Until unless you show them, nobody will believe that this technology can work and can be accepted by the user. So this is the most important thing which we have to do. And we have made some roadmap on this. And probably we will showcase them some technology-based construction in Delhi or around Delhi.
Okay. Now my question is, 25 cities, have they already been shortlisted or is there going to be a competition to shortlist them?
Yes, absolutely.
There will be a competition. They're not yet shortlisted, right?
No. You see, on this subject, I don't know. Ministry must be doing this. We are not part of this whole exercise.
All right, fair enough. So I'm going to move on then. Just stick to what you can comment on, sir. Now, the most important question I have for you is, Mr. Mittal, that, you know, we keep talking about almost a 2 crore shortage of homes in India. Mission Housing for All 2022 was essentially to meet this gap. If you look at the numbers today, you have about a little over 1 lakh homes which have actually been completed under PMAY since 2015 when the mission was launched, and about 24, 25 lakhs have been sanctioned. The numbers, I mean, at this rate, it seems that it's going to take forever. My question to you is the target too big or is the pace too slow?
The target is not too big. The only thing is the pace is slow. And still, again, the question is same. Still, we are in same mood, brick and mortar. Unless we change it to new technology, you cannot achieve this number in another 10 years. That's why Honorable Prime Minister said, you go for new technology, latest technology. If you adopt new technology, this number is very small. You can do it in the next 5 years. I'm 100% sure.
Mm-hmm. My final question is that I've also heard that probably the housing shortage has been overestimated at 1.8 crore homes. There might not actually be that large shortage because for lots of houses or flats built under PMAY in smaller towns, there are really no takers even today.
See, this number is probably is correct, not inflated number. The only problem is the people who are living in slums, if they have one jhopri or one space of 30 square meter, but they have surrounded area of 100 square meter, which is free of cost they are using and creating slum in that area. And for that reason, they are not willing to go to pakka house or multi-story house, which is 300 square feet, because they will lose that 100 square meter open space, which they are using free of cost. So numbers are correct, probably numbers may be more than this. Even in the small town, tier 2 town or tier 3 towns, you must be seeing that combined family in a house of 3 bedroom, 4 families are living, 4 children and father and son are living. And they need some house. So probably this number is correct, but we have to change the mindset and we have to create some kind of environment so that people are, accept these kind of things.
All right. Mr. Mittal, thank you very much for joining us and giving us this exclusive on that housing technology, a low-cost housing technology that the ministry is planning to launch under your umbrella very soon for speeding up the process. That was Mr. Mittal of NBCC. We are now also joined by former Housing Secretary Arun Kumar Mishra and in Mumbai with Chandrasekhar Prabhu, who has been the president of MADA. So we would like to cover all corners on this discussion and debate. Mr. Mishra, I'm going to come to you first. You've heard the NBCC chairman. This is the competition that, you know, now we are lagging so much in numbers. We've actually only built about 1 lakh or a little more than 1 lakh homes, sanctioned only about 24 to 25 lakh. 2022 is not far away. How are we going to meet that mission if we don't actually introduce and get states to adopt low-cost technology? How feasible is that, sir?
You see, we really don't have a choice. The targets might be a little steep, but we have to try to achieve them. The system technologies that you're talking about,
Mevan technology, the steel structures, I mean, all of these are well known and the private developers are using them.
Now that Mr. Mittal has mentioned that he has started using it, just about 3 years ago, when I left the ministry, the issue was that NBCC, of course, was not the body which was approving the technology. There is a separate body which approved the technologies. We had identified about 8 to 10. They were still in their trial stage. And the most important bottleneck at that time was that this technology will have to be accepted by the CPWD and also by the state PWDs. The idea was to make it a part of the state PWD schedule of rates. Other than, if you don't do that, just telling a state executive engineer, do this, he will not do it, because ultimately he will have to follow the system. That is why these technologies, while they were in existence in India, they were adopted more by the private sector than by the government sector. But now it is heartening to note that NBCC has started doing it, which basically means that Government of India has already approved this technology.
So we are saying that NBCC can actually showcase some examples and that might make states adopt it even a little bit.
Showcasing we have been doing for quite some time.
Showcasing has been happening.
So
now what do you need? You need tomorrow, Danda?
And there are lots of private sector people who have actually been constructing this.
Right.
Now NBCC has started doing it. No, Danda is not required. Important point is that You make the amendments in the state PWD schedule of rates.
All right. Hold your thought there. We will come back to you. Mr. Chandrasekhar, MADA's experience. Mr. Mishra said, the problem is the technologies have been available, but state agencies are simply not adopting them. Why not? I mean, look at MADA's record. Don't you think if you had adopted in your tenure, during your tenure, if you had actually adopted these technologies, the end result and the numbers of houses that you could have actually delivered would have been so much higher?
First of all, let me address the issue squarely. I don't think the issue has been even understood. There are two different things. One is affordable housing and the other is housing for all. Please don't confuse between the two. What is affordable to me may not be affordable to you. The government has made a formula that what is affordable to a person is 5 years annual income. Now, If you were to take 5 years annual income, I have given an example of the highest paid bureaucrat in the state of Maharashtra, shall we say, or in the country, getting a lakh of rupees or lakh and a half rupees salary per month. At lakh rupees salary per month, a year salary is 12 lakh rupees. 5 years annual salary is 60 lakhs of rupees. In Mumbai, where the chief secretary lives, and in the area around, in 60 lakhs of rupees, he cannot even get a garage, forget a house. Now, if the highest paid bureaucrat in the city cannot afford affordability cannot be done. That is number one. Please understand. So affordability, why I'm coming to that? Because in Mumbai, the cost of construction is not even 10% of the total cost. So construction doesn't matter. The price going down by 20% is not going to make a difference in metros, especially in Mumbai. The main issue is land, and there is no land available. So when there is no land available, how are you going to make it? Now, before that, I must complete.
Give me 10 seconds. Sir, because your voice is very important. We have to take a break, unfortunately. We will come back and I will come to you first, sir. Very quick break. We'll be back.